people get better and then they get a flare, and it's extremely distressing. And in fact, it's an expected oscillation.
For people that are on this long-term treatment, is their progress linear, or does it tend to be all over the place symptoms-wise?
Well, it's not. Originally, I used to think it was all over the place, but it's what what we strive to do is to achieve something called damped oscillation.
Mm-hmm.
Now, damped oscillation means that your symptoms and your disease oscillate, but if it's damped, each peak is less than the last one.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a crucial thing. And we can nowadays, we will produce a damped oscillation in the symptoms and in the urine microscopy. And if we can't see a damped oscillation, then we'll tell the doctor, this isn't going right. We've got to alter this. If we do see a damped oscillation, we'll then be able to say to the patient, stick at this by dogged persistence, this is what you want. Now, it's incredibly important to understand that, because people get better and then they get a flare, and it's extremely distressing because they think, oh my God, I'm going to get back to all that again, and so on and so forth. And in fact, it's an expected oscillation. And we understand a lot about damped oscillations. In fact, we can produce chemical reactions that will do damped oscillations in the test tube for us. And it's an expected phenomenon of biology, because it's an expected phenomenon of chemistry.
Mm-hmm.
Where I'm not happy is when it's not damping, when it's all over the place. If someone's all over the place, then we're not doing anything sensible.
Is it that point where you would change the protocol?
Yeah, definitely.
And what does that usually mean, more or just a different antibiotic?
Well, sometimes it means increasing the dose. The way we'll go is the principle is you try and stick to your original prescription. The principle is try and remain loyal to that. Mm-hmm. So you'll try and get past it by altering the dose, all right, and getting the dose out. And if that doesn't deal with it, then you'll change.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's no way of knowing what antibiotic you should be using, because there's no way of knowing what bug is causing this. So we run a protocol that you go from this one, then you go to B, then you go to C.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in some individuals that they notice an effect, but it's incomplete.
Mm-hmm.
So we mark that, and then we run through the sequence, and we may find that we can detect a partial effect in another one, and we put them together.
Okay, sure.
Now, that classically happens. We do that an awful lot with the beta lactams.
Mm-hmm.
So the beta lactam will be cefalexin and a penicillin. So there are a portion of our patients who are on a penicillin and a beta lactam for no other reason than that gets the dose high enough to have an effect. And mm-hmm. similarly, in some patients who've got a certain subgroup of infection, where they'll end up on a tetracycline and a macrolide. And once again, that is just to get the dose up sufficiently to have that impact. And why the dose? Well, it comes back to the thing, these infections are deep down inside the tissues, inside mm-hmm. the cells, and they're protected. You just need a concentration to get there.
Right. Are there patients that present in the first instance in a way that means that you just attack it in a different approach, like with a different type of antibiotic than you normally would?
Much less nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
The reason being is that we found that our judgments on we thought we were smart asses and could judge what was the best treatment to mm-hmm. think, and we discovered we were so incompetent at that. So nowadays we stick to a rigid protocol.
Okay.
And in fact, oddly enough, this morning I got a message from one of the doctors doing the clinic saying, could you look over these notes, because I haven't stuck to the protocol. And the reason was that the patient came in and described a really good effect for one of our first line agents. So the doctor went for that one instead of our normal first line. And I thought that was a perfectly reasonable decision. Mm-hmm. But one of the things we've had to learn is to, and when you've been brought up on urine cultures that, mm-hmm. you know, and it's ingrained into you, they're telling you what the bug is and they're telling you what antibiotic you should use. It's extraordinarily difficult to shake off that right. conviction. So we do an enormous amount of training in the fact that you can't judge what is the right antibiotic to do. You've got to do it through a protocol. That's the way you get there.
Mm-hmm. I know with the diagnostic side of things, you don't look for a causative pathogen, but in the research that you're doing, do you find that certain organisms seem to be mapped to certain sets of symptoms in patients? Okay,
this is quite a common question that we're doing. We are about to embark on a very difficult experiment to crack the problem of causation. Mm-hmm. Now, I happen to know that it's going to be difficult because of other similar experiments we've done are really tough. You've got to be extraordinarily disciplined and you've got to work with a large number of patients over a long period of time. Mm-hmm. And at the end of it, we're hoping that we will get some kind of indication of what's causing what. To date, we absolutely have not been able to link certain symptom clusters with certain microbes. Okay. Some patients, I once had a very entertaining patient. I used to describe her different symptoms in terms of by naming them after a microbe of some kind.
I've heard that too.
She was absolutely convinced it did. Anyway, it's fine. That's where she wanted. Now, I'll give you something. We are extremely suspicious that a certain cluster of patients suffer from what are called obligate intracellular microbial mm-hmm. infections. So that is mycoplasma, rheoplasma, legionella, molecules, and what's the famous one in that? Chlamydia. Mm-hmm. But we're only suspicious of that because of their propensity to respond to a certain antibiotic class, namely... Okay. tetracyclines and macrolides. We haven't caught the bugs in flagrante yet and we haven't fingered them. What we can say is that we have exonerated chlamydia. But I mm-hmm. often get approached by people saying I have a ureaplasma. And really my response is, well, I should hope so. We can find ureaplasma as often in normal controls as in patients. So it's a perfectly normal bug to find there.
In certain cases, could it be causing an issue for people though? Theoretically?
It's theoretically, yes, but I think people have got to be honest and not know. I mean, if you look at there's a Venn diagram once in the book that illustrates the fact that if you take the species isolated in the bladder and compare them with patients with these symptoms who have not been on an antibiotic, patients who have been on an antibiotic and normal controls, there's a 90 to 95% overlap. Mm-hmm. And you know, if you're seeing, we isolate ureaplasma using genetic methods as often in the normal controls as in the patients. Mm-hmm. So one of the things I will say, I think that the urine infections are probably being caused by bugs that were, you know, are present in the normal microbiome.
Yeah. Okay.
That makes sense. We're going to have to pin it down. And in fact, you see, the trouble is you get a species like E. coli, but there are all sorts of subspecies in there. And the 16S ribosomal genomics that people are using do not achieve the degree of subspecies analysis that's necessary mm-hmm. to pin it down. But to say what's causing it, not only is the clinical method difficult, but in fact the laboratory microscopy and the basic laboratory methods are fiendishly difficult to pull off.
How close are you to doing that research?
Hmm?
How close are you to doing that research?
Oh, we're getting going. Okay. We've sort of Harry, who's our head of our basic science program, he's hammered out the basic science methods, but it's incredible. It's like sort of cracking the Enigma code, but you've done well. We got it, and we got the good equipment to do it. And we're about to launch off with a cohort of patients that we will follow longitudinally through. Unfortunately, we built up such large numbers coming through the clinical service nowadays that we will be able to populate that quite successfully.
What's the time frame for that study?
I'm not really sure, but I think that we will be reviewing results every couple of years.
I want to ask a couple of practical questions about your approach. Do you use the same treatment protocol for male and female patients?
We start them off the same. All of that, and that was because that was because I was being a smart ass with the men, and I thought, okay, we'll start them off on the standard chronic prostatitis program. And to my embarrassment, we then discovered, in fact, I'm dealing with a man this morning who has responded superbly to our ordinary regime for the women. So once again, I learned from that. The cluster analysis, when we look at our data in aggregate and do these Bayesian cluster analysis, we can see the men grouping, some of the men grouping and tending to group around the tetracyclines and macrolides, which is no surprise. That's the way we approach the treatment of chronic prostatitis. But one of the things that fascinates me in this is that when we got our men on treatment, they tend not to get acute epididymal orchitis. Okay. And they're on a tetracycline and or a macrolide. Now, we treat acute epididymal orchitis with augmentin, you know, the broad spectrum penicillin. So that's a bit of a head scratcher for me. So I'm quite interested in looking at that in time.
Have you done any studies with male cohorts, or has it mostly been with female?
Well, most of it's been for females because all the doctors who come in to do PhDs with me are gynecologists. And so they do it. But we're about to start working with the part of the program that we got ahead of us now is going to have a very, very important group of men. And and it really is because of it's helped a great deal that urologists are starting to stop seeing us as sort of wild mavericks and so on and so forth. So that the patients are coming through. I mean, one of the problems was that in the dark days, you know, you had units who had rules that under no circumstances are our patients to be referred to that unit. Now it's reversed. And it's quite the opposite's happening. But that held us back, particularly with men.